Hello everyone, I am Bob and this is the Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining channel. In this design series episode, we're going to cover how to design a radiator cooling loop. So with that, let's get started. Hey folks, before we begin, I want to know what you are building in your Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining setup. Whether it's a carefully designed wonder of craftsmanship or something held together with duct tape and baling wire, I want to see it. And so does everyone else. After all, we are all learning how to figure this out, and the more we share, the more we can learn about how to do this better. So, send me photos of your setup, along with your name, location, and whatever else you want to share about your build. Send your information to the email address shown below, and I'll be showing your home builds as part of future episodes, so we all can see what can be done with Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining setups. So with that, on with the episode. Okay, so in this episode, I'm going to cover the design of the radiator cooling loop for a dual-loop immersion mining system. Now, the purpose of this loop is to transfer the heat from the heat exchanger to the radiator outside the house where miner heat is going to be released into the environment. This loop can also be used to transfer heat to your furnace, your hot water heater, and wherever else in your house you want to use your miner heat. Now, we could start from scratch and design a cooling loop from the ground up, figuring out things along the way, but there happens to be an existing technology that is a perfect match here, and that is hydronic home heating systems. Hydronic systems have been used in homes for as long as houses have been heated, and so there's a ton of technology, equipment, components, and how-to information out there. So what is a hydronic system? Well, it's a heating system consisting of a boiler, which heats a water-based coolant. That coolant is then pumped around your house using a circulator pump, and that coolant passes through radiators to heat rooms, floors, or whatever else you want to heat up. Now, the term boiler is a bit of a misnomer. In early hydronic systems, water was boiled and steam flowed in the piping around your house, and there are still steam-based systems out there, but most home hydronic systems nowadays do not boil water. They just heat it up to somewhere between 90 and 180 degrees Fahrenheit. And that's exactly the same temperature range of fluid exiting a home Bitcoin immersion mining setup. So, if we just build an average home hydronic system and then replace the boiler with a miner cooling loop, we have everything we need to heat our house with Bitcoin mining. Now, there is one slight difference between a hydronic system and a home Bitcoin immersion mining system. And that is, in a home hydronic system, often water is returned to the boiler without fully cooling it down. In Bitcoin mining, this won't work. We need the fluid to completely cool down before it returns to the miner, otherwise it'll overheat. But this isn't a big deal. We just need to add extra radiators to a typical home hydronic system to completely cool the fluid. Now, given all you can do with hydronics and all the many different types of system layouts and techniques that can be used, there is no way that I can completely cover this topic here. And so in this episode, I'm just going to try and cover the basics. If you want to learn more, there's an amazing resource to learn everything you possibly could want to know about hydronic systems, and that is Kalefi, which is a major manufacturer of hydronic system components. They have published a free set of journals covering the basics and specialized topics of hydronics. They are really easy to read and easy to understand. They also have a very extensive YouTube channel, including a series of videos called Coffee with Kalefi, where experts with decades of experience talk through real system applications, walking you through all of the basics. I think these are a fantastic resource if you want to learn more than the limited overview I can provide here. I put links below for all this information. So when starting off in designing a hydronic system, one of the first things to look at is the circulating fluid itself. Now, the first obvious choice is to just use plain water. Water has a huge heat capacity, meaning it can hold and move a lot of heat. It also has a relatively low viscosity, which means it's not that thick and can be pumped through a piping system fairly easily. But water has a bit of a downside, and that is it can freeze. So for all of us in parts of the world where winter can bring freezing temperatures, which is most of us, something has to be added to the water to lower the freezing temperature so that the system can run through the winter. And that something is glycol. Glycol is generally referred to as antifreeze, but there are actually two different types of glycol to use. Those are ethylene glycol and propylene glycol. Now, both will work to lower water's freezing temperature. Here's a couple charts showing how adding each type of glycol affects water's freezing temperature, but they do have some differences. Ethylene glycol is generally a little better at transferring heat, but it is toxic for both you and your pets. Propylene glycol is not quite as good for transferring heat, but it is not toxic, and according to the FDA, it's actually safe to use in your food. And this is the general trade-off, safety versus performance. You'll have to look at your system and make your own choice of which fluid will work best. Now, regardless of what coolant you use, the basic components, construction, and operation of the hydronic system are going to be the same. And the first thing to understand about a hydronic loop is that this is going to be closed and pressurized. This means it is not open to ambient air like the minor cooling loop. This loop is totally sealed at all locations and all the air is removed. The reason why a closed pressurized loop is used in hydronic systems is that it totally removes pumping height effects. With a pressurized system, it doesn't matter how high your cooling loop has to go. Even if you are pumping hot fluid from your basement all the way up to the second story in your house, the only thing that matters is the resistance of the fluid flowing through the piping. Height doesn't matter. And this means you can use a relatively small pump with low electricity costs to drive fluid all around your house to utilize your mining heat. Now, designing a pressurized hydronic cooling loop for a mining system isn't too hard. Here's a simple diagram of what you need to include. First, you'll need an expansion tank. The fluid will expand once it gets hot, and without this tank to absorb that expansion, the hot fluid would burst your system. Next is the air vent. For the pressurized loop to operate correctly, all the air must be removed from the system. Now, most air is going to be removed when the system is filled, but there still is always some residual air that will gather at the high points in the system. Air vents help remove that air. A similar component is an air and dirt separator. There are microscopic air bubbles entrained within the fluid along with dirt and debris. Both air, dirt, and debris need to be removed for the long-term operation of a loop, and an air and dirt separator will get this done. Now, with all of that air leaving the cooling loop, fluid must be added back in to keep the system pressurized, and so a makeup system must be added to ensure the loop always stays filled and maintains system pressure. Next up, to move the fluid through the loop, we need a circulator pump. And finally, the system needs a few valves. Filling and draining valves are needed to fill and drain the system. A pressure release valve is needed to protect the system in case of overpressurization, and additional valves can be added to close off parts of the system for servicing or controlling where the heat flows to different parts of the house. Now, when it comes to the arrangement of these components in the loop, there are a few rules and some rough guidelines you need to follow. First, the expansion tank must be located right before the pump. Now, I'm not going to go into the reasons why. It's a little complicated, and the Calefi info in the links below explain this in depth, so if you're interested, you can get more information there. Next, the air and dirt separator should also be located before the pump. This isn't a hard and fast rule, but removing the air and, most importantly, dirt and debris right before your pump is a pretty good idea. Also, the air and dirt separator and pump should be placed downstream of the heat exchanger. This way, the air separator will be removing the air from hot, low-pressure fluid, which maximizes its effectiveness. Finally, an air vent should be located at any high point in the fluid loop to help entrapped air escape. Now, when it comes to other valves, these can be added anywhere where it makes sense. Filling and draining valves are a good idea to make it easy to get fluid in and out of the system. Putting valves before and after the pump is also a good idea so you can easily service or replace the pump. And adding valves before and after major components can also be helpful to isolate them if you have to drain other parts of the system. With all the components in place, the next question to ask is, what size of pump and piping should you use? And this is where, again, things can get a little complicated, but it's workable if we take this step by step. And the first step is to figure out the fluid flow rate that is going to be needed. In a past episode, I covered some recommended brazed plate heat exchanger sizes used to transfer heat from the minor loop to the cooling loop. I listed sizes for both 1 and 2 minor setups. As was noted in that episode, Figuring out flow rates and temperatures is a little tricky, and it's best to use a heat exchanger calculator or have a vendor work out the details for you to get the numbers right. But for the specific heat exchanger sizes listed in that episode, a good rule of thumb is you want to flow around 1.5 gallons per minute for a one miner setup and around 2.5 gallons per minute for a two miner setup. Now you can always pass more fluid through the heat exchanger. More fluid means more cooling and better performance. So when in doubt, more is better. With the fluid flow rate set, the next step is to figure out the piping size. And for hydronic systems, it is best to keep the fluid flow velocity in the pipes between 2 and 4 feet per second. If the flow is less than 2 feet per second, the flow might not be strong enough to clear out air pockets in system components. And if the flow is higher than 4 feet per second, the fluid flow might make audible noises and might start to erode away parts of the system. Now, combining target flow rates with minimum and maximum flow velocities, we get a range of pipe diameters to use. Doing some math and looking at standard pipe sizes, here's what you'd get. For a one miner system flowing about 1.5 gallons per minute, 1/2 inch copper or 1/2 inch PEX piping should work. And for a two miner system flowing around 2.5 gallons per minute, 1/2 inch copper or 5/8 inch PEX piping should work here as well. And just a quick tip, if you are going to use PEX tubing, you'll need to use tubing with an oxygen barrier, which will prevent air from seeping through the plastic and into the fluid over time. With flow rate and piping size figured out, the last step is to pick out a circulator pump. Now, I covered sizing a pump for the miner cooling loop in a previous episode, but that loop was open to the air, and so that sizing method won't work here. With a pressurized system, the height of the cooling loop doesn't affect the pump size. Instead, only the resistance to flow around the cooling loop matters. And so the key here is to estimate how much total resistance is in that cooling loop. And it's not that hard to put that estimate together. After planning out the design of the loop, simply make a list of each and every component going around the loop. This includes every fitting, every valve, and every component the fluid passes through. For each component, you'll need to find out the equivalent length of a straight piping having similar resistance to fluid flow. There are tables in the information link below and other sources that can give you that equivalent length information. These equivalent lengths are then added together, and that total is added to the length of ordinary straight pipe in the loop. And this results in a total equivalent length for the entire cooling loop. Once we have the total equivalent length, there's a fairly simple formula to turn that equivalent length into a fluid head estimate for sizing the pump. Now, the parameters here can be a little confusing, and they are listed in detail in the links I provided below. But to keep things simple, for a one miner system, a very rough estimate is that head height is equal to 0.08 times the equivalent length. And for a two miner system, again, a very rough estimate is that head height is equal to 0.2 times the equivalent length. So now with both a fluid flow rate and a fluid head height, we can use pump curve charts given by pump manufacturers to pick out a circulator pump. I described how that works in a previous episode if you want to see an example of how that works. Now, there is a lot of estimating going on here, so there is some uncertainty when picking out that pump, and that's why it is probably a good idea to pick out a multi-speed pump if possible. This will give you the ability to handle a case where you've overestimated or underestimated the size of pump by simply increasing or decreasing your pump speed. Now, with the piping size and pump picked out, the next question is, how do you pressurize a hydronic loop? And this is where a makeup system comes into the design. A makeup system is simply a pressure regulating valve that maintains the hydronic loop fluid pressure. It does this by down regulating a high pressure source to the low pressure inside of the hydronic cooling loop. In most cases, the high pressure source is going to be your city water supply, which can range from anywhere from 40 to 80 psi in most locations. Now, a pressurized hydronic loop runs at about 15 to 35 psi, so a pressure regulator valve set to around maybe 25 psi, connected between your city water and your system, will keep the hydronic system operating at the right pressure. Now, there are a couple important details here. First, if you are going to be using city water, a backflow preventing valve must be in place to prevent any hydronic system fluids from flowing back into your drinking water. That's really important. Second, if your system uses a glycol water mix and you have maybe a small leak, water being supplied to your system will slowly dilute the glycol until it loses its antifreeze property. So leak checking your system and watching for leaks over time is also really important here too. Now, when you start up your system and radiator cooling loop, everything initially is cold. And as the system heats up, the fluid in the radiator cooling loop will heat up and expand. This expanding fluid needs somewhere to go, or it will damage or rupture your pressurized system. And that is what the expansion tank is for, to absorb this expanding fluid. Most expansion tanks are built with a flexible rubber diaphragm separating an air chamber from the system fluid. The air is pressurized to push back against the pressurized fluid in the loop, but the diaphragm will give, allowing the fluid to expand while maintaining system pressure. Now, there are a bunch of calculations you can do to find the exact size of tank you'll need for your loop, but the cost difference between a small and large tank isn't that much, and oversizing an expansion tank really doesn't hurt. So for a 1 or 2 miner setup, a 2 or 5 gallon tank will work fine here. So that's a very quick walkthrough of a hydronic cooling loop. And as I noted at the beginning of this episode, this is just enough to get you started. There's a lot more information out there on designing and building a system, and the links below are a great tool to making sure you do this right. In future episodes, I will be covering how to expand this basic cooling loop to include heating your water and heating your house. And in those episodes, I'll add more details on hydronic design where it makes sense. So that's it for the secondary cooling loop. I covered a lot of basic information covering hydronic system design and listed some great links below to learn more. In the next episode, I'll cover how I use this information to build my radiator cooling loop. So with that, bye.